Hey, welcome to my garage. This is my garage band tryout for a worship band, any worship band that'll take me. I want to just do a quick intro. So my name's Al, and I want to introduce you to my band members. I got my percussion over here hanging off the couple drums somehow. This is my big bass drum, I know that. This is my most important one, the kazoo. Also, for those special moments, I've got a lighter. I'm going to be using that. My cordless power drill, that's important. Big tube, and this is super cool. Let's see if this works. Well, when I was a kid, we always got in trouble because at restaurants, we always played this instrument with a fork and a knife, right? This is one of my specialties because I've done it since I was a little kid. And of course, every cool band always has a carpet. I don't know what the purpose of the carpet is, but there it is. Also, you'll notice I'm not wearing a hat. There's a lot of cool worship bands that wear hats. John Foreman, for example, from Switchfoot. Bear Reinhardt from Need to Breathe. Amberly Martz from Yarrow Alliance always wears a hat, rocking it. I just have long hair, and I didn't gel it. I didn't put any product in it, nothing. Anyways, this is going to be a song that I'm going to perform for you, and maybe it's an audition tape. And it's We the Kingdom and Holy Water coming up.
Good morning. Welcome to Yarrow Lions Church. It's a hard act to follow, but my name is Sydney, and I have a short devotional for you this morning before we worship together. So if you want to turn to Matthew 6, starting in verse 25, it reads this. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or stow away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And then skipping down to verse 33, it says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Now, these verses are a lot easier to read when you feel as though you already have everything that you need. They're much more difficult to read in times like today when we're very practically asked to trust God. Now, I was chatting with a friend this week, and she encouraged me to take inventory of my life. And what she meant by this was, look at all the things in your life and take the time that we have now to weigh which are the things that produce goodness and joy in your life, and which are the things that maybe aren't as important or just take up space. So there's a lot going on right now that we're not in control of. For example, maybe you can't go get your eyelashes filled, or you can't watch the sports you want to watch. You can't get your hair cut. Cam won't get his hair cut. So there's a lot of things going on right now that we're not in control of. But I guess my encouragement for you this morning would be, to one, seek his kingdom first. To two, really take hold of what you do have control of in your life. And then three, let go and trust God with what is out of your hands. So before I turn it over to Jan, would you pray with me? God, we just thank you that you are good and that you are in control. Lord, would you teach us to trust you? And would you remind us of what is really important in life? God, we look to you and we trust you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to Food for the Soul. And today on our menu, we are going to be making tuna boats. Our lesson today is from Mark chapter 1, where Jesus calls his disciples. And they were fishermen, so that's why I went with tuna boats. So to start off with tuna boats, you're going to need a few ingredients. We're going to start with tuna. We're going to start with onions, apples. I've got cheese, celery. I'm going to need some toothpicks and some curry powder. Now you can change things up a bit, but you're going to still need the tuna and the celery and the cheese. So, and some mayo. Now I think I've covered everything this time. We're going to mix it together, and there's a certain way that you have to do it in order for this to work properly. So we start with our tuna that we've drained, and we have it in our bowl. Now I picked apples because we're going to start with something crunchy. Now you can put something like walnuts or pumpkin seeds or something else that's crunchy in your tuna boats. You have to have something crunchy. And then I put red onions, because that's got flavor to it. And I'm going to add that to my tuna. And then I'm going to add just a little bit of chili powder. Curry powder. You can add chili powder, because that's spicy too. So some spice in there. And the disciples that Jesus called, they were all different kinds of disciples, all kind of different men. They were, some were crunchy, some were savory, and some were a little spicy. And Jesus is kind of like the mayonnaise who kept them all together. And he called them and he said, you know, the kingdom of God is near. And you guys, you need to get your lives together and you need to follow me. And so he said, come, follow me, and let's get this all together. So he got them together, he mixed them up, he said, put it all together, follow me. So we're going to mix this up really well. Now, to make a tuna boat successful, you have to do it in the right order. And to do that, you have to take your celery, Cut it into a nice length that you can handle. Take your tuna and put it carefully on top of your boat. This is going to be your boat. So layer it on nicely. Then what I've done is I've taken a piece of cheese and I cut it in half and diagonally took a toothpick and I've made a little sail so that it can go on the boat. And there's my little tuna boat. So Jesus, he told his disciples, leave whatever you're doing, leave your boat, leave your fish, come follow me. And you know what? Your life is going to be amazing. So make sure when you hear Jesus say, follow me, put down what you're doing and follow him. See you next week.
Well, good morning, church. My name is Cam. I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and I just have a couple announcements to keep you guys in the loop. So the first one is our AGM, our annual general meeting, is coming up next weekend, April 25th. And we're going to be doing that over Zoom. And so if you are a member and you want to be a part of that, please email Carol. So RSVP, RVSP, one of those. I got roasted last time because I mixed it up, but it's one of those two. So email Carol, carol@yourallliance.org, and she can send you the link and give you all the information to join and be a part of that. One other thing is giving. And so our offices has actually moved. So if you are going to be giving through check, you cannot send it to our office in Chilliwack anymore in Sardis area on Vetter Road. That office is closed down and we're not there anymore as we transition to move to Yarrow. So if you want to give by check, please send it through mail to the church building here in Yarrow. We also can give online, which is probably a lot easier. So you can go onto our website, hit the big give button. You can give by card, through PayPal, or you could set up automated giving if you want. And to do that, just email kim@yarrowalliance.org, and that's the easiest way. And with that, I'm going to pass it to a video to Jen Forbes.
Hi, I'm Jen Forbes, and I'm the chair of Yarrow Alliance Church, for those of you who don't know me. And I just wanted to speak to you today with a financial update for the church, because I know many of us are going through lots of changes in our personal lives, but then also in our church. And I wanted to make sure that all of our members are on the same page, and we can't meet together right now. And so this is the only way we can do it. So I just wanted to go through what we're doing as an elders board to make sure we're staying proactive here at the church instead of reactive when it comes to our finances. Many of our programs have been closed down because we can't meet in person right now. And so we knew that that would change our budget forecasts. And we also know from the last few weeks since going to online giving, we've gone from a position where 50% of our giving to the church happens in the plates during the service to 100% of it basically online at this point. And so we're seeing a up and down trend as we're going along, and we needed to take a look at that. We went into COVID already behind in our giving as a trend, about 25%. And so we needed to take a look at the numbers. So the elders board tasked our treasurer, Brian Zaporozin, our bookkeeper, Kim Douglas, and Pastor Sean with looking at those numbers and seeing what it is that we need to do and where we can make some cuts. And so going into this, our budget looked like about just shy of $51,000 needed a month, and they have managed to trim it down to about $35,000 a month, and they need to be commended on that because that took a lot of hard work. And so how did we get to here? Well, first of all, you need to know that your pastoral leadership has unanimously approved and encouraged a 10% salary decrease for the next 3 months for themselves. They know that there are a lot of families that are looking at their own budgets and cutting due to job loss, and they wanted to lead by example in the church. And so they have taken that 10% pay cut for the next 3 months to help us with our cash flow. We've also ID'd some government programs, such as the Canadian Emergency Wage Subsidy, which we will be able to take advantage of to a degree. So I'm going to put a slide up now and just kind of go through that. Our operating expenses going forward will be covered by our general weekly giving. And then we also have a $100,000 balance in the bank and a $40,000 line of credit. But we hope that you as a church community will continue to give, because we can burn through our reserves very quickly. And we want to be able to still serve our community. So our new office renovation is the second bullet point, and that's already in progress. There's nothing we can do about it. So we took it out of our budgeted items, and we have, as an elders board, okayed the liquidation of some interest-bearing funds that we have to cover that renovation, and that should be finishing up in spring. We will be taking advantage of any COVID relief programs offered by the federal government to help with cash flow demands. And we have also authorized the Canada Emergency Business Account application for an interest-free $40,000 loan to be repaid in the next 2 years. And that will allow us to get a $10,000 grant from the government if it is repaid within those 2 years. And so the long and short of it is we are in a good shape, but we'd still need to be proactive, and the needs in our community are not changing. And this is a time for us as a church family to lean in. We just disseminated a lot of hampers in Yarrow this last week, and we're going to need to do that again in summer. The needs aren't changing. They're increasing. The needs on our pastors are increasing. The way they pastor is changing, and we need to be supportive of them. We need to make sure we're encouraging them. And as a community, we need to encourage each other to just lean in, to connect with each other. Even though we can't connect physically, we need to connect through media and through notes, and just checking in on our neighbors and making sure that the church in a pandemic is a shining light in a lot of darkness. So I thank you for your time. And please, if you have any questions, read through Brian Zaporozin's report. It will be coming out with our AGM documents, and it really breaks this down quite nicely. Thank you.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Oh, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, the hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will walk the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear you lost, you hold on me. I
Well, good morning. Welcome again. My name's Sean, and I'm lead pastor here at Yarrow Alliance. And I want to move into a time in the Word this morning in Mark's Gospel, picking up in our series. But I want to set the stage this way. When you think about what the calling card of our culture is, in many ways, I think it's urgency, or actually a false sense of urgency. That may indeed be the calling card of our day, this idea that there's this urgency, but it's not necessarily a true sense of urgency. Before COVID, most of us were busier. No doubt it was the tyranny of the urgent that had this disproportionate amount of influence in our calendars. Family dinners, where everybody sat at the table together, they were fewer and further between. Quiet evenings, playing games at home, did not happen so regularly. Date nights with your spouse were far apart from one another. Maybe they didn't even happen at all. There was always one more thing that was calling for your time and your attention right now. Globally, there was this sense of urgency with climate change. And this had been growing for some time. Greta Thunberg was on a global tour, urgently telling anyone that would listen that climate change was the biggest challenge and crisis of all of our histories. That was before COVID. Seemingly urgent things, big or small, didn't matter. important or trivial. All of these things were clamoring for our attention. But then really, the urgent things changed, didn't they? I mean, first, it was toilet paper. You know, people shopping for toilet paper with ridiculous urgency. I mean, even now, don't get me wrong. I mean, it's important to have toilet paper. But when you go into a store now and you actually see toilet paper on the shelf somewhere, you have this feeling, don't you? I know you do. And you feel like, I should buy it because it's there. I've got 32 rolls at home stockpiled, but I see toilet paper on the shelf in a grocery store and I have this like sense of urgency. I should buy some more toilet paper. But then it was hand sanitizer, right? Sold out everywhere. Distilleries have been starting to produce hand sanitizer. Craft beer breweries have been making hand sanitizer, and they're giving it away for free to frontline workers, which is amazing. But this past week, I heard about a distillery in Abbotsford. Here's the promotional sale. If you buy 2 bottles of their alcohol, they will give you a free bottle of their sanitizer that they've created as well. Like, who would have thought ever that sanitizer would have been like a sales, you know, tactic, that was what was going to get people. But then it wasn't just sanitizer, then it was Lysol wipes, right? Everybody's running out of Lysol wipes and we're all looking for them. Then it was the meat aisle, and you'd find yourself in the grocery store and you'd see people just clearing out the meat aisle. And so stores started putting a limit on how much meat you could buy and how much other supplies you could buy. That's where it all started, this urgency to shop for things that somehow you knew. I mean, you knew that animals were going to continue to be around. They weren't disappearing. You knew that these things would never really run out, but you felt this urgency to buy it all. And now it's changed yet again. It continues to evolve. So this past week, the things that people cannot find on the shelves, it's hair dye for the ladies, I assume. Hair clippers for the guys. And now there's all these kind of COVID hairstyles coming out. Now it's dumbbells as well. I was talking to somebody in Australia this week, actually, on a Zoom call. And in Australia as well, they can't get dumbbells anywhere. And so I checked online this week for used home gyms, used equipment, dumbbells. Not because I need them, right? Because I've got a whole bunch in my basement that I don't even use anyway. So, I mean, Jimmy Fallon last week, one day, he writes these thank you notes on his show, and it's kind of a satirical, a poking fun at things, but he said this. He said, "Thank you, Home Gym, for helping me realize every time I said to myself, if I only had a little more time, I was just lying to myself." Anyway, these are strange times. This sense, this false sense of urgency, it prevails in so many ways. Dumbbells and hair clippers, like, come on. Now, of course, the trouble with all of this, this media-driven, fear-driven sense of urgency that we seem to constantly live with, is that if all we do is get pushed and pulled back and forth into buying or doing things because of a false sense of urgency, then eventually, when something that comes along that is actually urgent, something that matters, something that's important, the trouble is, when that something comes along, we might actually dismiss it because we're so familiar with just everything clamoring for our attention. We might miss it altogether. We might just put it off. In Mark's gospel, where I want to pick things up this morning in the first chapter, what Mark records are the first words of Jesus in Mark's gospel, and they come with an actual sense of urgency. It's different than the false senses of urgency that we face every day. So if you have a Bible with you this morning, or you want to find it on your phone and you want to join me, Mark is the second book of the New Testament. You've got Matthew and then Mark, and they're called Gospels. Gospel literally means good news, and that's how Mark began his gospel in verse 1. In Mark chapter 1, verse 1, he says this is the beginning of the good news, or the gospel, about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So first, let me remind you, friends, that what we're going to read and study through in Mark, it's good news. It's good news, which is a welcome bit of information when much of the news that you and I consume these days, it's not good news, right? It's not that good. But the first verse is the title for the whole gospel, and from this opening comment on through verse 13, Mark chapter 1:1-13, it's basically a giant introduction to Jesus. Mark begins in verse 2, and we've looked at this in weeks past. We've looked at the ministry of John the Baptizer, From verse 2 through verse 8, we've looked at the baptism of Jesus in verses 9 through 11. And we've looked at the solitude and temptation of Jesus in the desert that preceded his ministry in verses 12 and 13. Now, all of those things Mark has put here in the opening section to introduce us to and set the stage for the time when Jesus began his public teaching ministry in Mark chapter 1, verse 14. And so, friends, verse 14 and beyond, this is a spot that marks the beginning of Jesus preaching, the beginning of a new unit, the beginning of all else that is coming for us in Mark's gospel. And that's where I want us to spend our time this morning. Mark chapter 1, beginning in verse 14. Let me remind you, friends, as I read to you, that this is God's word to you and to me. Mark 1, verse 14 says, after John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he says. It's time. The kingdom of God is near. Seek forgiveness, change your actions, and believe the good news. Now, as Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I'll make you fishers of men. At once, they left their nets and they began to follow him. And when he had gone a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and when they left their father Zebedee, they left him with the boat and the hired men, and they followed Jesus as well. This is God's word so far. Now, after John's arrest, Mark says, Jesus begins his ministry, and the message that he begins to communicate is what Mark starts with. The way Mark sets it up, though, it creates this sense of urgency for us, that is a legitimate sense of urgency, that Mark has designed his opening chapter of his gospel to move us, to call each and every one of us to respond. And it's not a false sense of identity or a false sense of urgency here in verse 14. When Jesus comes and he says, it's time. How many of you have ever heard of a man by the name of Bruce Buffer? Bruce Buffer is a household name mostly in combat sports, in mixed martial arts and somewhat as well in the boxing world, but basically in combat sports arenas, when the fighters have come down to the arena and all the pre-fight amble is over, preamble's done, this older guy, Bruce, he's got this, you know, coif of hair, freshly slicked back, all puffed up. Sometimes he's wearing this velvet or I've seen him in a sequined tuxedo jacket. And when the next item of the night, the next part of the fight night is the main event, Bruce Buffer takes center stage. This microphone comes down from the ceiling and Buffer takes the mic in his hands and he looks around at the crowd and he begins by talking about this is the main event and he starts to introduce the fighters from their countries, where they're from, what they weigh, their records in the ring, that sort of thing. And then he gets to this pre-fight moment where the crowd knows that Buffer's going to say his famous line. And he does it this way somewhat, and you'll forgive me for butchering this, but he looks around and he says, and now, ladies and gentlemen, he says, it's time! And the crowd, as he does that, erupts into great cheers. The main event is beginning. You know who else said, it's time? Yeah. Jesus did, yeah. In Mark 1:15, after his baptism and then his temptation in the desert with the devil, after coming out of the desert and after John the Baptist is put in prison, Mark 1:14 says, Mark says, it was time for the main event. And when Jesus comes back into the region of Galilee, verse 14 says, he began to preach and proclaim the good news of God. And Jesus said, it's time. The kingdom of God is here. Seek forgiveness, change your actions, and believe this good news. Now, here's the thing. When Jesus says it's time, you need to sit up. You need to pay attention. He says the kingdom of God is near. This isn't just some sports entertainment event. The kingdom of God is here. Seek forgiveness, change your actions, believe this good news. And this, friends, this good news that Jesus brings, it's not a false sense of urgent news like you'd get on like Fox News or on some conspiracy video on YouTube or something like that. No, this is Jesus. the Son of God's own announcement for a shifting in history, a shifting in eras. It has arrived. The time has come, he says, and God has begun something new and history-changing and life-changing, and it will impact you, friends, and it begins right now. Now, here's the thing. I wonder if these days, when faced with something pressing, something that actually matters, I wonder if it's not the same as all the other urgent messages, the false urgency, the seemingly urgent things. I wonder if we recognize it's not the same. This is God talking to you and me. And I wonder if oftentimes when God speaks, if because we're so bombarded with seemingly urgent things, even though when God speaks it's different, I wonder if many of us will spend a little too much time thinking about what God says to us and not enough time responding or taking action when a real response and real a real action is most appropriate. It's what Jesus is looking for. Real response. A few weeks ago, because when we think about real urgency, it always produces a real response. Well, a few weeks ago, I was running around picking up some things. I think I was at the office, and I was on my way home. I don't exactly remember why I had been out, what I was looking for, but I was on my way back, and as I hit Keith Wilson, and so I'm literally maybe, you know, 3-4 minutes drive from home, my car begins ringing with the phone, and my car answers the phone automatically, which is really terrible sometimes when you're driving and you just kind of, you don't want to talk on the phone, but your car automatically answers the phone, and I don't know how to turn this setting off. So after a couple of rings, the call picks up, and all I can hear is my daughter Eden and my son Kaim, and they're on the phone, and they're sounding pretty frantic, and I get this message over the phone that, "Dad, Avea, our youngest, she's locked herself in the bathroom, and she will not open the door." And in the background, of course, I can hear Avea, and she is screaming in pain. You know, having three kids as we do, I learned early on, as all parents do, that there are different kinds of cries that kids make all throughout their lives, but you know, because there's the "why did he get more popcorn than I did" kind of cry. There's the "I'm overtired" cry because we've been up too many late nights, or then there's the "I'm not getting what I want" cry that, you know, the 4.5-year-old makes, and that sometimes is the 13-year-old that makes the same sound. I don't know, understand what's going on, but all of these cries, they all convey something. They all try to communicate something, but aside from all of those kinds of cries, there's this one cry that goes way, way deeper to the soul of a parent, and it brings something up. It instills a true sense of urgency into every parent's soul, and it is the "I'm hurt and I need help" cry. And if you have kids, you know this is the one that does something to your heart as a parent. You're melted. It goes way beneath your nerves, strikes this deep, deep chord in you, and it is the cry of a child who's really been hurt. It pulls forth this urgency in you. You have to do something and answer that cry. It's urgent that you take some kind of immediate action. And so I'm on the phone, I'm in my car, and Eden, as I'm driving, she gets Avea to open the door, and she realizes that Avea has actually spilled a boiling pot of macaroni on her stomach. And she's got a severe burn. And suddenly, my little Honda Civic acquired the prowess of a sports car. And I downshifted, and I flew along Keith Wilson. I almost may or may not have almost ran down Tony and Karen Demers. And Tony's back there, and he's doing, I think he was just, "Hey, Tony, hi." But I almost took them out. But all I knew was I have to get home, like now. And I'm telling Eden over the phone to start a cold bath and get Avea into this cold water immediately. So I get home in minutes without any further misses of humans. And I run upstairs and I get to work with the kids, trying to get a sense of, like, how bad is it? And really, I didn't spend too much time overthinking it. You know, I knew right away that I had to give a response to Avea. I had to take action. Now, the end of the story, it could have been a lot worse. A few nurses live next door. They came over really quickly, actually, and the burn was second degree, but within a matter of 3 weeks or so, Avea has completely healed up so well. But you know that cry, right? There's that soulful response that something rises up in you when you realize you are not dealing with a false sense of urgency. There is something incredibly important going on, something right in front of you that needs a response from within you right then and there. When Jesus begins to preach in Mark's gospel, the first words that Mark describes coming from Jesus come with that kind of sentiment that upon hearing Jesus speak them, we would respond today. That it would be a soulful response, that it would be followed through on with actions in our lives. Let's think about the way that Mark sets this all up. We've seen Jesus get baptized. We've seen heaven open, and the voice of the Father has spoken a word over Jesus. You are my son, and I love you, and I'm pleased with you. We've seen Jesus go from that experience witnessed in the public setting into the desert place, the solitude place, where he is fasting for 40 days. He's tempted by Satan himself. We've seen Jesus emerge from the desert, victorious over the temptations, victorious over Satan. Now John the Baptist is arrested and put into prison. This is not just another day, not just another media update. No, this is the context in which we hear the voice of Jesus saying, hey, listen, it's time. The kingdom of God is here. And so no matter how you come at it, the impression we're left with here in Mark's gospel is some kind of immediate human decision and action is being called for. It's not a one-time decision either. It's an everyday decision about the kingdom of God. That's what's at stake here. Decisions and actions. That's what Jesus is looking for. After all, Jesus says it's time. The kingdom of God is here. Seek forgiveness, change your actions, and believe this good news. Now, it is early in Mark's gospel, I realize. Some people, though, at this early stage are going to get stuck here on the words of Jesus. Just they're going to get stuck and they're going to start thinking about all kinds of big things instead of realizing that Jesus isn't inviting us to get stuck and stop and just start thinking about what does the kingdom of God mean? What does this mean? What does that mean? What he's looking for, what he's doing, he's inviting us to do something here. This announcement from Jesus doesn't require that we just think about things. It instead comes with a sense of urgency, a call to take some kind of immediate action. The kingdom of God is near. Seek forgiveness, change your actions, and believe, Jesus says. And here's where some people get stuck and they don't move. Because to seek forgiveness, or some translations use the word to repent. Douglas Garland has written, this is something that prevents a variety of obstacles for people today. First, because people tend to wince when they hear the word repent, or they are told to seek forgiveness, because many times this has been a misused concept and it's been used to instill guilt or shame into listeners. It's been used even to condemn people. But in contrast to guilt and to shame, the idea here is not to expose shortcomings at all. The call of Jesus to seek forgiveness is not a scathing call or a reprimand. Instead, to repent or to seek forgiveness, as Jesus calls us to, is to receive and respond to an invitation from God, to switch allegiances in our lives. Jesus extends to us a summons, and it does require some immediate action from us, because he's calling on every person who hears these words to respond to God's presence and God's initiative in our lives. The kingdom of God is here. God is present. God is with us. God is here. God is at work right here, right now. Sadly, many people don't hear invitation when they hear these words from Jesus, because some have heard something from someone else, somewhere else along the way, and associated is this bag of shame or of guilt or some idea that in order to repent, you know, you got to have a come to Jesus moment at the front of a church sometime somewhere. And if you don't do that, you haven't repented. Or maybe it's that you got to do some kind of a penance thing. And even though we don't come from a tradition that actually teaches penance, somehow I have this sense at times that I need to make it up to God somehow. For some people, when they hear the call to repent or seek forgiveness, they feel this guilt or this shame, or they think, but I can't come to God yet until I have things sorted out. But that's not what Jesus is asking of us. That is actually the opposite of what Jesus is saying. Remember, this is not bad news. This is good news. It's good news. And so, what Jesus is inviting us to is a change of course. He is inviting us to turn a corner in our lives, to turn our backs on some old things, maybe some old patterns, some old sins, but also that we can begin something new with him, something kingdom-oriented. Now, let's be clear. God always wants us to stop going our way and start going his way. When he says we wander off from him, it's like sometimes we forget about him. We start going our own way. But foundationally, what Jesus is calling for here on a heart and soul level is this change in allegiance in our lives. He wants you on his team. He wants you playing for him. He wants you working for him, living for him. But some will get stuck because seeking forgiveness does mean that we take ownership for the ways we've been trying to make life work without God. So it means we have to acknowledge sometimes where we've taken wrong steps, where we've been wrong, and we do have to say we're sorry. That's a part of shifting gears, but that is an obstacle for some, because for some of us, there's this sense of shame and guilt that just kind of overwhelms when we think about those things. For others, it's not shame and guilt, but for some people, with the call to repent or the call to seek forgiveness and change your actions, I wonder if what rises up is actually just anger. Anger. I think sometimes we get angry at God when he calls us to repentance, because anger is the response that comes anytime anyone would dare tell you what you have to do. I mean, we've seen this over the last couple of weeks, last couple of months, in many parts of the world where COVID-19 has not been taken seriously by certain people in kinds of pockets, or sometimes even in countries, they have not acted. They may have even said, well, it's serious, but I'm still going to look for loopholes so that I can personally, or that we could collectively, defy governments or medical professionals' directives. Like, you know, when people started coming home maybe a month or so ago, maybe 5 weeks, 6 weeks ago, when people started coming home from international travel, it is no fun being told that you have to self-isolate for 14 days. I mean, you wish you were the exception, right? That the rules didn't apply to you or shouldn't have to apply to you. It's not fun. Or when you think about even here in town in Yarrow, how weeks ago the skate park down at Pioneer Park, it was taped off. It was literally closed. But for the next week or two, the kids were seen, like, literally taking down the tapes. And they put fences up around. Kids were seen climbing over the fence just to go and use the skate park. Because it sucks. You know, kids being told you can't come out and play as you normally would. You can't hang out. You can't congregate together. When we're told to stay home. But then on the weekends, you know, we see it throughout the province, people going in droves out to their favorite hiking trailheads and parking like a parking lot, and there's no social distancing on the trail, so much so that parks got shut down. You know, when hair salons and barbers got shut down, I mean, like, seriously, how am I going to keep my look going in a pandemic? Like, it's going to get ugly, but it sucks being told where you can go, where you can't go, what you can do, and what you can't do. I know, because by nature, we hate being told what to do. Worse, we hate that we've been called out if and when we've been wrong about something. But you know that this is the result of refusing to take our sin seriously. I mean, we do sin, don't we? We do what we shouldn't do in thought, in attitudes, in words, in actions. And then at times, it's the other side of the same coin. We fail to do the good that we know needs to be done. And either way, we often try to escape or minimize or avoid being held accountable for things. That's human nature, but that is a problem. See, the problem is, for most of us, when things go right, we'd like to take a lot of credit for it. But when anything goes wrong, most of us would like to pin the blame on someone or something else. And this isn't news. This isn't a new trend. This is exactly what happened in the Garden of Eden when Adam sinned. His first response, with pride rising up in his heart, was to blame both Eve and God for his sin. The woman you put here with me, she gave me the fruit and I ate it. But then Eve was no different. The serpent deceived me and I ate. And so sometimes, friend, we have this blind spot that it's at work in our lives, and we become so adverse to taking responsibility that when we get to a place of being stuck in sin or in stubbornness or in our blindness. And Jesus speaks into our souls. And unless it was for Jesus speaking in, we would essentially just go on and on spiritually, emotionally, relationally blind, going on through life, so to speak, losing conscious awareness of our need and our desire for forgiveness. From a kingdom of God perspective, which is an eternal perspective, when we don't admit that we have a problem in our lives, or when we don't admit that we cannot get better without external help, we'll never turn to God as a solution. We'll never answer the urgent call of Jesus here when he says, it is time, he means it. It's time to switch allegiances. It's time to give over this part of your life you've been hanging on to and live fully connected to Jesus. Live as a part of his eternal kingdom. So to summarize, sometimes people get stuck at Jesus' first words because they don't understand what Jesus means when he says, seek forgiveness, believe the good news, change your actions. This is the good news. Romans 3:23 says, even though everyone has sinned and we all fall short of God's standard, the good news is that God, in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight. He's done this through Christ Jesus, who frees us from the penalty of sin. Freedom. A clear conscience, a life aligned with God. That is good news. Now, finally, this is one more obstacle I see in this passage that plays itself out in our lives today. And it is perhaps the one that maybe is most relevant. This is the one Jesus seemed to go after the most in the Gospels. Sometimes we get stuck and we get stalled out on Jesus' words, not because we have a shallow view of sin, but because we actually have a shallow view of repentance, we have a shallow view of seeking forgiveness and of changing our actions. What I mean is, for some people, the call to seek forgiveness and change your life, it's been heard so many times, right? It's almost old hat. It's almost too familiar. It's been something that's become passé, almost so commonplace, and so much so that we no longer even fully grasp the meaning of repentance. Sometimes people, the kind you find in religions like Christianity, they find that it's easy to go through the motions of confess, repent, but they've actually not realigned their lives. They haven't changed their attitudes. They haven't reflected on and allowed God's word to penetrate into the deeper places of their heart and soul where their actions come from. Sometimes like King Claudius in Hamlet, who asks, may one be pardoned and retain the offense? People acknowledge the wrong in their lives, but then they just kind of carry on doing it anyways. Sometimes we're like King Herod in Audens for the time being, who said, I like committing crimes, God likes forgiving them. So sometimes we get stuck in a walk with God because of what Jesus says that we don't respond to, even as people of faith. We hear the words, you know, the time has come. He says, seek forgiveness. I go, yeah. Change your actions? Yeah. I don't know. Believe the good news? Yeah, I believe. But they stop at confession and we proclaim belief, but we never respond to all of what Jesus is saying. His kingdom, he says, is about freedom. It's about transformation. It's about freedom from guilt and shame and freedom to become who God has intended us to be. So here's what this opening message of Mark has for us. It has a call to recognize the urgency with which Jesus says we need to hear him and we need to respond to him. He has a call to seek forgiveness and to change your actions and to put your trust and your belief in who he is. This is good news. This is something Jesus intends for you and I to consider regularly. This is not a one-time thing. It's not an end goal thing. This is the beginning of Mark's gospel, the beginning of the journey with Jesus. It's about aligning ourselves and our souls and our hearts and our minds and our actions, everything we have around Jesus and his kingdom. And it's something then that will give shape to everything about you and about me forever. So what does this look like played out in your life? Well, to answer that, Mark gives us a short example. What does repentance look like? What does a change in actions look like? What does it look like to believe? And Mark says this, as Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and they followed him. And when he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. And without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee and their boats and the hired men, and they followed Jesus as well. One day, Jesus goes out, and he meets these men, and he invites them, he calls them to follow. And this is where I think it gets interesting. Because why on earth would these two sets of fishermen decide, seemingly quite suddenly, it says immediately, in fact, why would they leave their things behind and begin to follow Jesus? Well, Mark gives us no explicit explanation. Let's look at what is clear in the text. What is clear is that these men don't take days on end to mull over their decision or to ask for, you know, their family, what do you think about Jesus? What should I do? They don't go to the fisherman's market and say, hey, you know that rabbi Jesus, he's telling us to follow. You know what, Jesus, I'll think about it. They don't do that. They answer. They respond to Jesus who stands before them. And let me tell you, friends, we don't see a come-to-Jesus moment here, a confession of sin. We don't see any church service. We don't see anything like this. But what we see here is their repentance. How do I know this? What is the evidence of their repentance? They leave their things. They change their actions. They put down their nets. They put down their boats. Whatever symbolic significance that may have had, they leave some things behind, and they literally begin to follow Jesus together. Notice again, that is their repentance. They followed Jesus. You know, they no doubt along the way came face to face with sinful tendencies and stubbornness and pride and anger and all these other things that Jesus was working through with them in their lives. But they didn't have to get it all together. They didn't have to have a special moment. They simply had to respond and begin to follow Jesus. Now, if we step back for a moment, in some ways that seems totally hasty, doesn't it? To take off after someone who happens to pass by and abruptly seemingly calls people to follow him. That's what Jesus seems to do. But let's be clear. We know something far deeper was happening when we consider both Luke and John's Gospels. These men that respond to Jesus, they didn't make a hasty or an impulsive decision. They made a strong one, a clear one, one that was calculated. Mark's point isn't their process. It's about their response to Jesus. In the other Gospels, we know these men had seen and heard about Jesus. Luke 4 describes how when Jesus began to preach, he also began to perform miracles. And it says he taught with the authority of God. And people were not only amazed and they praised him, it says, but word of Jesus began to spread throughout the whole country. The reason Mark's silent on some of those details is because he assumes by the time we get to verses 14 and 15, when Jesus says it's time, when Jesus begins to call people to the kingdom of God priorities, he assumes, Mark says, we should already know about Jesus. We've already done a little bit of meeting Jesus. We know he's the Son of God. Mark's already told us. We know his kingdom is divine and eternal. We know he's already battled and been victorious over Satan in the desert times. We know he has the anointing and approval of God the Father on him. He is God the Son. And so Mark's purpose here isn't about describing all the things that led up to why did these men particularly choose to follow Jesus. His point is that when Jesus speaks a word, people respond because of the one who gives the word. When he says it's time to seek forgiveness, it's time to change actions, it's time to shift priorities and allegiances, Mark wants us to realign everything around Jesus in his kingdom. Because Jesus matters that much. You matter that much to God. It's time, friends, to reassess, to take inventory, and to realign around God's kingdom. Let me ask you, have you done that? Have you done that? Because the reason Mark explains it this way, describing it as this sudden and immediate response of the disciples, is Mark wants to have us capture and respond to the significance of the one doing the calling. When Jesus calls, this is God calling you. When he calls, he says it's time to get things sorted out with God. It's time to take a look at who you are and who he is and who he says you are, what he wants to do in your life. It's time to stop building our own little kingdoms, to stop choosing our own adventures, to stop deciding for ourselves what will make us the most happy or the most money or provide us the most meaning. It's time to take seriously the person of Jesus Christ and explore who he is and what the implications of his true identity and the implications of following him really are in our lives. It's time because it is God the Son calling you. This is different. In Oz Guinness's book, The Call, he says, our first calling in life, our first call, the one above every other calling, it is first and foremost to someone, not to something, not to some place, but to someone, to Jesus, to be walking with him, to be united with him, to be aligned around his great and perfect purposes in our lives. Nothing else will satisfy like Jesus. And so what Mark is highlighting by giving us not all the peripheral details, but by giving us the call of Jesus and the response of those who hear him, is that his call is different. It is urgent, and it brings forth a response from within us. There's something completely different here. When Jesus calls, this is not a proposal. This is not a suggestion. This is not food for thought. This is God speaking, and his words are powerful, and they're transformational. Because when we think about what Mark lays out for us, and in Mark chapter 1, he says, Jesus comes speaking and saying, it's time. Come and follow me. Align your whole life with me. Bring it all under the banner of the kingdom. And the disciples that we meet in Mark 1, they're compelled, they're responding, they're following Jesus, they're joining the band of disciples, those who are following him. Mark chapter 1, verse 25, it goes on. Mark says another time where Jesus speaks, we see the power that his words bring, even to evil spirits there. In Mark chapter 1, verse 25, Jesus encounters these evil spirits that are tormenting a man, and he says, be quiet, come out of him. And even evil spirits respond to Jesus in obedience, and they leave those that they torment. In Mark chapter 2, verse 11, Jesus speaks to a man who is paralyzed, and we're going to take a look at that story in a couple of weeks from now, but he says to this man, get up and take your mat and go home. And a man who's paralyzed gets up, healed, takes his mat and walks out of a house full of people. In Mark chapter 4, verse 39, Jesus speaks, be quiet, be still, and the wind and the waves obey him. In Mark 5, Jesus speaks, talitha kum, to a little girl who has died. And this word, this phrase, talitha kum, means little girl, get up. And a girl who has died comes back to life. His words are powerful. They bring a response, don't they? Psalm 33 talks about this power of God when God speaks to you. The psalmist reflects on creation itself. He says, for he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. So friends, this is the backdrop for understanding the response of the first disciples in Mark chapter 1. This is the backdrop of understanding that should lead you and me to respond to Jesus. When he speaks, we respond. When he speaks, creation responds. When he speaks, the wind and the waves respond. Sin and shame respond. Sickness responds. So how about you and me? Do we respond to Jesus in these kinds of ways? You know, there's a difference between me telling you as a pastor to follow Jesus. It's a big difference. Between moms and dads telling their kids to follow Jesus. A big difference between grandmas and grandpas praying for and telling their grandchildren, follow Jesus. There's a difference between you telling your friends to follow Jesus and Jesus himself speaking to people, saying, it's time, come and follow me. You and I can tell people about Jesus, and we should. You and I can tell people to follow Jesus and explore Jesus and investigate Jesus, and we should. But Jesus, the Son of God himself, speaks. And he spoke to these men and he said, seek forgiveness, change your actions, believe the good news, come follow me. And they heard Jesus speaking to them and they knew this message was for them. And they felt that something rising up within them and they responded to Jesus and they left things behind and they began a new chapter. They began to follow Jesus more and more from that day forward. Now, friends, let me tell you this morning, if you're seeking God these days, if you're seeking love these days, seeking direction or meaning or purpose, whatever it may be, I want you to recognize within God's living word that he is speaking to you. He is calling you. He is saying in this season, yet again, it is time. The kingdom of God is here. God is at work around you. And so if these days you find yourself asking questions about what really matters in life, in your family, in your calendar, in your finances, wherever it is, when a pandemic hits and you find questions of faith and of God stirring, you find this inclination towards God is present in your thoughts. It is my hope for each one of us that you will recognize that this, friends, this stirring, this questioning, these are nothing short of the work of the Holy Spirit. The voice of Jesus is rich and present and speaking to us. And maybe it's the first time that you're recognizing this. Maybe it's the first time in a long time. But it is my prayer that you will recognize the voice of Jesus and give him all of what he's asking of you. Now is the time to follow Jesus. Now is the time to go all in for him. Now is the time to reorder your life and your calendar, your priorities around the kingdom. And like these disciples in Mark chapter 1 who did it together, friends, let's do it together. Now is the time to follow Jesus together. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we hear the call. We recognize the times we're in. And we confess there are so many false senses of urgency out there that when we hear your voice, your voice cuts through all the chatter. You speak to us about kingdom things. You speak to us about soulful things, about family things, relational things, things of grace and of change and of transformation. And you speak to us, Lord Jesus, of eternal things, a kingdom that has no end. And you invite us to become a part of it and to walk in step with you in your kingdom, to join you in the building of your kingdom and to live as sons and daughters who will inherit a great inheritance in your kingdom. And so Jesus, again today, while this may be familiar, we open our hands to you, we open our hearts to you, and we ask you, Jesus, by the Holy Spirit, would you expose within us any areas you want to call us out from into a life of greater freedom, a life of greater purpose. If there are things we are hanging on to that we need to lay down or lay behind us today, I pray, Lord Jesus, in your name, you would give us the courage and the grace to do it. If there is shame or guilt that rises up in us when we think of seeking forgiveness, I pray your words of grace would silence the voice of the enemy who would seek to condemn. I pray, Jesus, that you would give shape to each one of us in this season. Give us eyes to see, Holy Spirit, that you are very much at work, that your kingdom has no end, and you are building it even now, pandemic or no pandemic, struggles or lack of struggles. God, we believe that you are the only one who satisfies, the one who holds the keys to heaven, to eternity, and to each one of our hearts. So, Jesus, we welcome you again. We declare again today that you are the Son of God, that we are yours, and that we will follow you together. In your good, good name we pray, Jesus, and everybody at home said, amen. And we're going to go to a song, and I want you to stick around because we've got some more to come after this song.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling. come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
Well, Jason and Jordan and Amberly, thank you so much for using your gifts this week to bless us through music. Amazing job. And it's so good to see some of our familiar faces on screen. And this morning, last thing we want to do is bless one of our familiar faces. Sydney, formerly Penner, now Block, is concluding her official internship with us this week at Euro Alliance Church. And Sydney, you've been with us pretty much a full year. I mean, longer than that, obviously, but as an intern working with youth, you have brought an incredible passion and gifts of communication and a shepherd's heart to kids, and we love you. We're so thankful for you. Normally, friends, when we finish an internship, what we would do is take a love offering, and that's, of course, a little difficult this season, so our board this past week has allocated a gift for you to say how much we love you and we're thankful for you. And this morning, I want to present that to you and say thank you so much. That is a pre-sanitized envelope. Don't worry. But quickly, could you tell us one or two highlights from the year? And what has God kind of impressed on you? What's coming in the fall for you? As I know this has been a journey of God-shaping vocation in you as well. So share with us briefly.
Yeah, the highlight has definitely been just getting to know some of the youth even better, and just learning more about my own passion for youth and affirming that, and that's the direction that I want to take. And then going forward, I'm actually finishing my last week at CBC, so Columbia Bible College, this coming week, and then I'll be graduating with a diploma in biblical studies, and then I'll be transferring those credits to UFV, so University of the Fraser Valley, and I'll be pursuing a degree in teaching. So kind of the thought behind that was I have affirmed my passion for youth and for Jesus, and kind of taking both of these paths will enable me to do that kind of in a church setting, but also in a school setting as well. So yeah, I'm really excited, and it's been such an encouraging and stretching year, and yeah, I'm just excited for what's to come.
Right on. Well, with that, again, we know you're going to continue on at Yarrow and be part of the church family, and I'm just going to ask Cam just to pray blessing over you and give God thanks for all that God's done in and through you. And so friends at home, would you join us in praying for Sydney?
Yeah, before we pray, actually, I was just spending some time with Jesus, and like, how do I encourage Sydney as she leaves, because she's just been a huge light and a huge help and support, and just so good for our youth ministry, for myself and for all the youth she's interacted with. And so I was led to Luke 7, and it's a story of a centurion, so like a high-ranking army official, and it's the story where the centurion has a servant, a slave, who's sick and who's ill, and he hears about this Jesus guy, and he goes out and he finds Jesus, and he asks Jesus, like, I myself am under authority, and I know when someone gives me a command, it's done. And so all I ask is for you just to say the words, and I know that your words have power and therefore will bring healing to my servant. And so this, I think what Jesus wanted to tell me to you, Sydney, is like, you are that centurion commander, and like, you are someone who knows the power of Jesus and who knows the power of Jesus. And you want so much for the youth to experience that power, and you want them to be whole, and you want them to be healthy and to be transformed by Jesus. And so, yeah, I just that's just who you are, is someone who leaves everything that they're doing in order to bring life and to bring blessing to other people. And yeah, I just also want to encourage you to, that's not done willy-nilly, that's done because you know the stories and you know the testimony of Jesus. And so continue to stay grounded in who Jesus is and in his stories, to stay focused in that and grow in your understanding and the power of Jesus. And so, yeah, and I think I've just seen so much of that happen this year with our one-on-one meetings every week, and just hearing the stories of the girl she's connecting with and the heart she has for them, and just the ways that like youth in our church have sought after Sydney and have found her phone number and just texted her and like, hey, can we go for a coffee? Can we hang out? I want to get to know you. I have some stuff I want to talk about. And so, yeah, just that, yeah, you have been such an influence and you made an impact on so many kids' lives. So, yeah, with that, let me just pray for you. And then I think we have another video for her. after this. Yeah, Jesus. Yeah, thank you for Sydney. Thank you that you brought her to Yarrow Alliance Church a few years ago. And yeah, just her heart to see people transformed by you. Just her heart to see people experience their best life and to figure out who they are through you and find their identity in you. So thank you, yeah, just for the gifts that she has, her heart of just being so relational, pastoral, gift of heart for community, just to care for so many of the youth in our church and that come through our doors Wednesday nights. Yeah, thank you for her leadership abilities. Thank you for her wisdom. Thank you for her compassion and, yeah, just her heart for prayer. And we thank you that she has been able to use that and you've been able to use those gifts, Jesus, to make an impact on the youth here. So thank you for the ways you've grown her and you've stretched her over this year to make her more like you and to lead her into your calling. Thank you for, yeah, just making paths clearer and giving her clarity as what's to next. And so, yeah, we pray a blessing over Sydney. We thank you again, and we solidify all the work you've done through her this year, and we thank you for just the lives she's been able to impact, the young people in this church that she's been able to impact, and just thank you that she is sticking around this church and wants to continue to build into these relationships. And yeah, just the way she's just said yes to so many things, to doing her internship here, not even knowing I was going to be here, not even knowing who was going to be in charge of her, but she wanted to stay intentional and stay relational with these kids, so she kept serving here. And so we honor that and we thank you. So Holy Spirit, would you come fill her now? Would you reassure of who she is? Would you reassure that she is being led by you and that she's seeing clearly the path you've laid out for her as she moves on to U of V and pursues teaching? Would you, yeah, just give her confidence and peace that this is the right decision, God? And would you just continue just to develop her gifts, to give her new gifts, and just to continue to show her who she is, and that she would be rooted in you and trust in your power and your guiding. So thanks again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Now, Yarrow, we're going to leave you here with a video slideshow just to express thanks to Sydney. The rest of us, stick around and take that in. But let me say now, we'll see you again next Sunday, same time, 10 a.m., live stream, and the peace of Christ be with you.
Hi, Sydney. Just wanted to say thank you.
Thank you, Sydney.
Thank you, Sydney.
Yo, thanks so much, Sydney.
Thank you, Sydney, for the amazing work you've done this year.
Thank you, Sydney.
Thank you, Sydney, for everything you've done for the youth throughout the whole year.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sydney, for interning at Yarrow Alliance this past year. You mean so much to everybody at the Yarrow Youth Group and everybody else around the church. Thank you.
Yo, Sid Vicious. Thanks for all your hard work as the intern over the past year. We'll catch you on the flippity flip.
Thank you, Sydney, for being such an awesome youth leader.
Arigato gozai masu.
Thank you, Sydney. You've been a big help at the church, and I really enjoyed having you as a leader last year.
Thank you, Sydney.
Thanks, Sydney, for being a good youth intern.
Yeah, thanks for everything you've done for the youth.
Hey, Sid. Just like to say thank you for all that you do for the church and all that you do for us girls. It's deeply appreciated, and we all really love you really much. Can't wait to go back to youth and see you again.
Thank you for always being there and listening to lots of my crazy life stuff and teaching me things, and it's been amazing. Thank you for being there since grade 7.
Hey, Sydney, I just want to say thank you for all the hard work that you've put in to make our youth group so much better and such a safe environment for all of us to be in, and just an awesome place to be. And I'm so happy that God led you here, and I can't wait to see
you for doing such a great job as the intern youth pastor. It was such a great year. I mean, it's not really ending right now, but yeah, thanks for everything, and yeah, making such great connections with the kids.
Glad to have you aboard with us this year. You've done a wonderful job being an intern. It was a pleasure getting to know you, to having a few discussions that we had before church. And I just wish you and Levi all the best. I just pray upon you a blessing and joy and peace. And you've had a wonderful impact on the kids. And I know that God will honor you and bless you for that. So thanks very much. God bless. And we'll see you later.
Thank you for all the time and energy and love that you've just poured into this youth ministry. Into with leaders and the kids, you've been an amazing friend and an amazing leader. And I think a really instrumental part in these kids' lives and their journey with Christ. So thank you for everything that you've done for our church. You were very, very appreciated and so loved.
Hey, Sid. I just wanted to give a big thank you to you and all that you've done in our church and through our youth group over this past year. It's been such a privilege just to serve alongside someone who's so passionate about youth and just wanting youth just to encounter and be transformed by Jesus. So thank you for just bringing a ton of fun, for being relational, for being intentional, and just saying yes. Saying yes to planning events, planning games, teaching, preaching, mentoring girls one-on-one, and doing all the behind-the-scenes work that goes unnoticed. Know that you've made like a lasting impact here in our church and in so many kids' lives, and that Jesus has used you in powerful ways. So I know I didn't say it enough, but thank you for all that you've done.
Thanks!
Sid! Oh.
I stubbed my toe!
I missed.